Good morning, everyone. In last class, we have discussed about the benign lesions of the oral cavity. Today, we'll deal with the premalignant lesions of the oral cavity. Now, coming to definition, what is a premalignant or a precancerous lesion? Can you hear my voice with this mask on, or you want me to remove the mask? Just reply. Fine, then I'll keep the mask on. Okay. So a pre-malignant lesion or a pre-cancerous lesion, it's a benign lesion which is morphologically altered tissue that has greater than normal risk of malignant transformation. It's a benign morphologically altered tissue that has a greater than normal risk of malignant transformation. The following are the common examples of the pre-cancerous lesions. First one is the leukoplakia. Next one is the erythroplakia. So these two are the most common and most important ones. And other important one is the submucosal fibrosis. In last class, we have discussed about oral lichen planus and oral candidiasis. So these are the lesions which are considered as the pre-malignant lesions. Now coming to leukoplakia. The name itself gives us some information. That is, leuko means white, plakia means patch. It's a white patch. So now coming to definition of the leukoplakia. It is defined by the WHO as a white patch or a plaque that cannot be characterized clinically or pathologically as any other disease. So it means it is a diagnosis by exclusion. So we remove all the obvious causes of this white patch. And if it does not come under any one of those, then we consider it as leukoplakia. And this term is only it's a clinical diagnosis. Okay. It is very important because it's a common 2 marks or a 4 marks question for you. Among these pre-cancerous or pre-malignant conditions, leukoplakia is one of the most commonest one. The question arises is, why this patch is in white color? It is clinically white in color because it results from the thickened surface keratin layer, which appears white when wet. Because you know that oral mucosa is coated with saliva, it is always wet. This hypertrophied or thickened surface keratin, when it is wet, it appears as white color. And also, a thickened spinous layer, which is nothing but a basal cell layer, which is near to the basement membrane. If this layer is thickened, then it masks the underlying blood vessels that is present beneath the basement membrane of the epithelium. So it masks the underlying red color of the vessels, and the thick keratin layer accentuates the white color. So these lesions appear white in color. See, this irregular surface, this white in color, it is due to thickened keratin. When you observe this histological diagram, you can see this is the thickened keratin layer. This is the basement membrane, and these are the basal cells or spinous layer. So this thickened keratin layer, when wet, appears white in color. This thickened spinous layer masks the underlying blood vessels and vasculature. So these leukoplakia predominantly appear white in color. Now coming to an important point. This is a pre-malignant condition. That is, it's a midway between a benign and malignant lesion. So these pre-malignant lesions have tendency to convert into malignant lesions. So that the tendency for oral leukoplakia to convert into malignant malignancy is 17 to 25%. The reason for this tendency to convert into malignancy is due to the loss of heterogeneity of this chromosome 3 and 9. P means short arm, Q means long arm. This and this number beyond this chromosomal number is gene locus. So it is not important not to memorize, just for completion's sake I'm giving you these details. So the loss of heterogeneity of 3p and 9p chromosome at 3.8 gene locus can increase the malignant potential of the lesion. Now coming to the epidemiology, how common is it? As I told you before, leukoplakia is by far the most common oral precancerous lesion, accounting for 85% of all the premalignant lesions of the oral cavity. Who develops it? The leukoplakia has strong male predilection, that is 75% of cases are found in males. Now coming to etiology. The etiology of leukoplakia is largely unknown, but there is high suspicion for this following etiology. The most common one is the tobacco. The tobacco or tobacco leaf and its products, they're consumed in various ways. Like they can be smoked, like in cigarettes and cigars. They can be chewed, like in gutkha. Okay? So any of this, either smoking or chewing the tobacco leaf, can cause increased risk of forming leukoplakia and also further malignant transformation. Other etiology noted is areca nut or betel nut, which is usually commonly used in palms. See, this is the image of the areca nut. The next one is the alcohol. See, what happens is the alcohol acts as a medium for the carcinogens to be adsorbed into the tissue. So whenever tobacco and alcohol are consumed at the same time or simultaneously, the increase in risk of carcinogenesis is increased by 15 times. Okay. The next one is the ultraviolet radiation. This ultraviolet radiation is a natural radiation, can cause actinic keratitis of the lower lip. This also increases chance for leukoplakia, and some microbial infections that can cause the leukoplakia. The final one is the trauma. Repeated trauma in the oral cavity can lead to leukoplakia, and if even then it doesn't stop, it can lead into malignancy. Last time I told you about what is occlusal line in the buccal mucosa. So if the patient has any jagged tooth or rough tooth or tooth with rough edges, it can constantly cause trauma and friction on the inner surface of the buccal cavity, causing leukoplakia, keratosis and leukoplakia. Then as we talked before, there is a role of some microorganisms causing in leukoplakia. The commonly ones are Treponema pallidum, which causes lesions commonly on the dorsal surface of the tongue with patients with syphilis. So Treponema pallidum causes syphilis. The other one is the Candida albicans. In last class, we talked about Candida. This Candida, apart from causing benign lesions, can also cause premalignant lesions, known as Candidal leukoplakia and Candidal hyperplasia. The last one is the virus, that is Human papilloma virus 16 and 18 strain can cause leukoplakia. Now, the role of trauma. As I told you before, constant irritation or constant friction can cause keratotic lesions, but they are found to have a less malignant potential. Other one is the nicotine stomatitis. Apart from carcinogens present in the tobacco leaf there is another active compound called nicotine, which is the reason for addiction. And also this nicotine causes a reaction to the mucosa in the oral cavity known as nicotine stomatitis. Frictional stomatitis, I told you before. So these lesions, once you stop the irritating factor, then they can be readily reversible, and patient can become normal at this stage. Now coming to clinical features. Leukoplakia usually affects the people over 40 years of age, more common in males as we talked before, and it is found that approximately 8% of the males above the age of 70 years are reportedly affected. Of the whole population, if you take the whole population of above 70 year males, you can find leukoplakia in 8% of them, which is a huge number. Approximately 70% of this leukoplakia, they can be found anywhere in the oral cavity, but they are more common in lip, vermilion border, buccal mucosa, and gingiva. And important thing here, the with respect to the site of the lesion is, whenever you find a leukoplakia on the ventral surface of the tongue, lip vermilion, or floor of the mouth, we should be very careful and take a biopsy immediately, because there is highest risk of malignancy in these sites, malignant transformation from these sites. The individual lesions can vary and change over time. Early lesions during earlier part of the disease process, they are slightly gray in color or grayish white in color. They're translucent or slightly raised, or they can be completely flat. They're well demarcated and they blend into surrounding mucosa. At this stage, if you stop the irritating factor, it can completely be reversible into normal mucosa. And if you take a biopsy of this early lesion, there is a rare chance of you finding in any dysplasia of the epithelium in the biopsy. Now coming to types of leukoplakia. They are thin leukoplakia, thick or homogeneous leukoplakia, granular or nodular leukoplakia, verruciform leukoplakia, proliferative verruciform leukoplakia, erythroleukoplakia, or in older days they used to call it as speckled leukoplakia. So there are various classifications of this leukoplakia. So I'm going to talk about some of them now. First one is the Sugar and Benozzi. They gave a classification to the leukoplakia. They divided leukoplakia into simple, varicosa, and erosiva. Simple consists of white homogeneous keratinized lesions which are slightly elevated. In varicosa, the surface is raised, obviously, and it is also irregular and appears like a wrinkled surface. Now coming to erosiva. Erosiva literally means erosion. So it contains white lesions with erythematous areas, erosions, and deep fissures. See, this is the example of leukoplakia simple. This is the example of verrucosa. How the growth is, it is raised from the surface of the mucosa and is also irregular. This is verrucosa type. And this is erosiva. You can see fissures and depressions in the oral cavity mucosa. Now coming to another classification. Pindborg and Associates divide the entire leukoplakia into only two types. That is homogeneous or speckled or nodular type. In homogeneous means the lesions are white in color. They are smooth. They can be smooth or wrinkled. They can have cracks or fissures. Other type is speckled or nodular. This speckled type, they contain erythematous base with white patches or nodular excrescences. These all are clinical classifications, that is based on external appearance. Now coming to histological classification. Leukoplakia is divided into leukoplakia simplex, papillary endophytic type and papillomatous exophytic type. See, in this diagram, in this histological diagram, you can see how the various types of leukoplakia differ. Now coming to thin leukoplakia. Normally, this is a normal epithelium. In thin leukoplakia, there is, see, hyperkeratosis. The keratin layer is raised. And some amount of acanthosis. Acanthosis means proliferation of cells in the spinous layer of the mucosa. And some lymphocytic infiltration. Now coming to thick fissured leukoplakia. See, thick means there is hyperkeratosis and also there is fissures. Along with that, there is acanthosis, means proliferation of the spinous layer. They contain some amount of dysplasia, these plastic cells, okay, along with some lymphocytic infiltration. Now coming to granular or variciform leukoplakia. Before you have seen the clinical picture of verrucous leukoplakia. Now it is histological. See, here in thick leukoplakia also there is hyperkeratosis. Here also there is hyperkeratosis, but the surface is irregular. Okay, along with that, this histological diagram also consists of bulbous retipex. These are the retipex containing dysplastic cells. These blue ones are dysplastic cells. These black ones is lymphocytic infiltration. Okay. And finally, erythroleukoplakia means they contain both white patches and also erythematous regions. This contains irregular hyperkeratosis. Irregular because, see, here there is hyperkeratosis. In between there is no hyperkeratosis. Again, there is island of hyperkeratosis. So, irregular hyperkeratosis. Bulbous retipex with epithelial atrophy. See, epithelium is atrophied in this region. So, this appears red in color because the superficial epithelium is deficient or atrophied. So, the underlying vessels can be easily seen because there is no keratin layer. So, that's where it appears red in color. So, it also contains retipex, dysplastic cells and lymphocytic infiltration. Now coming to another important lesion, it is also 2 marks question for you. Another important type of leukoplakia, it is known as proliferative verrucous leukoplakia. It is a high risk form of leukoplakia. It is similar to any leukoplakia, but it contains multiple keratotic plaques with rough surface projections initially. And rough surface projections. Initially, they are like any normal leukoplakia plaque, but with progression of disease, the surface becomes irregular. They tend to spread slowly yet progressively. PVL or proliferative verrucous leukoplakia has high chance of malignant transformation potential. That invariably they turn into squamous cell carcinoma within a period of 8 years. All the leukoplakia have strong male predilection, but PVL has strong female predilection. See, there are multiple sites in the oral cavity. This is one side. See, on the base of the tongue, this is one side. See, and this here it is ulcerative. You can also see on the ventral surface. So, multiple sites. And this is also example for PVL. See, it is a raised lesion. Irregular surface is irregular. In the same individual, on the ventral surface of tongue, you can see. On the buccal cavity, you can see. And also over the gums. Now coming to histological features, we already discussed. Histologically, if you take a slide of leukoplakia, what you'll see is thickened keratin layer. It is known as hyperkeratosis. With or without thickened spinous layer, it is known as acanthosis. So, Now coming to, we're saying dysplasia. What are the changes that occur in a case of a dysplasia? When a normal cell becomes dysplastic, it has following features. They are enlarged nuclei. In pathology, you have learned enlarged nuclei and cells. Large prominent nucleoli, increased NC ratio, that is nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. Hyperchromatic nuclei, pleomorphic or abnormal shaped nuclei. Dyskeratosis, that is premature keratinization. Increased mitotic activity and abnormal mitotic figures. And we have seen in the earlier diagram, there is characteristic bulbous or teardrop shaped heti ridges, loss of polarity, keratin or epithelial pus. This is predominantly seen in squamous cell carcinoma, but in some dysplasias also you can find it. Loss of typical epithelial cell cohesiveness. See, this is a stage of hyperkeratosis. In this stage, there is only the proliferation of the epithelial cells along with thickened keratin layer. See, thickened keratin layer. Look at this heti ridges, they are not bulbous. But once dysplasia occurs, you can see the cells lose their shape, nucleus size increases, nucleus cytoplasmic ratio increases. You can see mitotic figures. See, mitotic figures. And also see, look at these heti ridges, they become bulbous. Earlier they were flat, which was normal. Now they become bulbous. Okay. In carcinoma, once carcinoma arises, there is no polarity. You don't know which is basal cell, which is superficial cell. So loss of polarity. You can also find some keratin pearls. Now coming to treatment or management. How do you manage this case? Mostly, no treatment is required. We'll observe the patient. But if your patient has any earlier risk factors, we'll go for a biopsy and send the sample for histopathological examination. If the histopathological slide shows dysplasia, we'll go for complete removal of the lesion. Okay. If the biopsy shows less severe changes, you'll go for conservative methods. That is, if the person is using tobacco, we'll advise him strongly not to use further. And we'll ask the patient to come at regular intervals of 3 or 6 months. We'll see if the lesion is improving or not. If it is deteriorating or there is increase in the size of the lesion or the number of lesions, then you'll go for repeat biopsy and see if there is any, if the lesion turned into malignancy or normally used drugs at this stage are retinoids, antioxidants. These retinoids try to maintain the epithelial integrity. Antioxidants remove all the free radicals that cause damage to the DNA, leading to malignant changes. And also finally, COX-2 inhibitors. So I told you, we'll clinically evaluate the case patient every once in 6 months. We can also remove the lesion completely either by using an electrocautery cryosurgery. In cryosurgery, you'll use liquid nitrogen. And another newer modality is laser ablation using KTP laser or CO2 laser. So long-term follow-up is important because there is chance for recurrence. And also if you remove the tissue inadequately, then they can also lead to malignant transform into a malignancy. So repeated follow-up is required. So that is the end of the leukoplakia. Now coming to erythroplakia. So what is an erythroplakia? Erythroplakia is defined as a red patch that cannot be clinically or pathologically diagnosed as any other condition, similar to leukoplakia. The erythroplasia or plakia was originally coined by Queiroz for describing a precancerous red lesion on the penis. Almost all erythroplakias, they demonstrate significant epithelial dysplasia. In leukoplakia, the chance of displacement is somewhere around 25%. But in erythroplachy, almost all cases can be have significant chance of epithelial dysplasia. So as for leukoplakia, the cause for erythroplachy is also unknown. So erythroplachia is far less common than the leukoplakia. There is great malignant potential. Erythroplachia plus leukoplakia, they invariably lead to, when there is a combination of these two lesions, they invariably lead to early invasive oral carcinomas. Now coming to clinical features. They're more common in older males, particularly in the 65 to 74 years age group. They're more commonly seen in the floor of the mouth, tongue, and over the soft palate. Early erythroplachias, they are well demarcated erythematous macules or papules, plaques with soft velvety structures. Unfortunately, it is usually asymptomatic. So in this picture, you can see the erythroplachia lesion. See, this lesion is present in the floor of the mouth. See, this is the location of the lesion on the buccal cavity. Now coming to histopathological features of the erythroplachia. Approximately 90% of them, the severe dysplasia is seen. In 90% of the erythroplachias, when you take a biopsy, there is a chance of you'll find in the report you'll find severe epithelial dysplasia, carcinoma in situ, or superficial invasive carcinoma. Typically, the epithelium shows lack of keratin production and is often atrophic. As I told you before, these erythroplachia lesions, they have characteristic feature, they lack the keratin production, that is keratin layer. So the underlying blood vessels can be easily seen through. So that's where they have characteristic red appearance. Now coming to treatment and prognosis. The diagnosis is obtained by biopsy. So whenever you find this lesion, and the patient has the risk factors like smoking or alcoholism, you'll invariably send the patient to have a biopsy taken. Then based on the report, if the lesions exhibit moderate dysplasia or worse, that is like carcinoma in situ or invasive carcinoma, you will have to remove the lesion completely. So the recurrence and multifocal oral mucosal involvement, the necessary long-term follow-up. So the important point is, if the lesions contain dysplasia or carcinoma in situ like features, we'll send the patient for complete removal. And also you have to monitor the patient clinically every 6 months to rule out any recurrence or further malignant transformation. Now coming to erythroleukoplakia. This term is used for lesions that contain a mixture of both erythroplachia and leukoplachia. Formally, they are either called, I told you before, they are formally called as speckled erythroplachia or speckled leukoplachia, depending upon which component is accounted for majority. So in this picture, you can see there's a red lesion. There's a red lesion over which you can find the wild lesion. So it contains both combination of erythroplakia and leukoplakia. That's why it's known as erythroleukoplakia. See, these are white lesions, white raised lesions. With the surrounding, you can find an erythromatous lesion. So it contains a combination of both a erythromatous lesion and also a leukoplakia. That's why it's known as erythroleukoplakia. Now coming to another clinical condition known as oral hairy leukoplakia. It is most commonly seen in patients with Epstein-Barr virus lesions and also HIV lesions. The lesions are more concentrated on the lateral border or lateral margins of the tongue. They are characteristically white keratotic vertical streaks, thick corrugated, and they have a shaggy surface. See, they are found on the lateral margins. They contain vertical lesions. The other common sites apart from this lateral margins are dorsum of the tongue, buccal mucosa, and floor of the mouth. When you send when you take a biopsy and send for histopathology, you'll find hyperkeratosis in this of this lesion. They contain irregular surface projections and irregularities, ballooning degeneration, nuclear alterations. So in this cases, management is not necessary. These cases are most commonly found in HIV patients. With antiretroviral therapy, when the person immunity develops, this also goes away. So no special treatment is needed. This is the histological diagram showing hyperkeratosis. Now coming to Plummer-Vinson syndrome. Point to be noted is it is not a precancerous lesion. It is a precancerous condition. It's an uncommon condition. It's more commonly seen in middle-aged females. It is characterized by iron deficiency anemia, glossitis, and dysphagia. So what was found out is there is high chance of oral and esophageal cancers in patients with this condition. So as I told you before, it is more common in females, particularly in the middle-aged females. It is found to be more common in Scandinavian and Northern European countries, but it's also more common in our country also. The patients predominantly present with symptoms like burning tongue or burning mouth, angular chelitis, and they present with smooth red tongue. That is, the irregular surface of the papillae of the tongue are lost. So as I told you before, one of the features is dysphagia. So the cause for dysphagia is esophageal web. A esophageal web is nothing but an abnormal tissue bands that are present at the level of present in the esophagus, at the level of cricopharynx or upper esophagus. These webs are formed usually. And this syndrome is also associated with spoon-shaped nails known as coilomania. As the person has iron deficiency anemia or nutritional anemia, apart from these symptoms, they also present with symptoms of anemia such as fatigue, shortness of breath, weakness, which often lead the patient to seek the medical care. Then when you inquire, patient also gives the history of frequent or long-term dysphagia. So when you send the patient for routine hematological investigations, when patient is blood is sent for smear, you'll find hypochromic microcytic anemia, which is consistent with iron deficiency anemia, and biopsy of the oral mucosa reveals epithelial atrophy with submucosal inflammation. In advanced cases, apart from this epithelial atrophy, you may also find dysplasia, carcinoma in situ, or frank squamous cell carcinoma. Now coming to treatment. The treatment is to correct the iron deficiency anemia, and also the person should be periodically evaluated for oral, pharyngeal, or esophageal cancer. The frequency of malignancy or malignant transformation in this patient is ranged from 5 to 50%. So this is the smear showing microcytic hypochromic anemia. This is a picture showing spoon shaped nails showing pyelonephria and reddish smooth tongue. You see the loss of, there is loss of papilla on the dorsum of the tongue. Now coming to another important topic known as oral submucous fibrosis. Oral submucous fibrosis is one of the commonest precancerous condition in India, apart from the leukoplakia we discussed before. So in this submucous fibrosis also, any part of the oral cavity may be affected. The commonest causes for the oral submucosal fibrosis are areca nut, that is betel nut. They contain an active substance known as ericolin, which stimulates the fibroblasts within the mucosa and causes in the increased production of collagen up to 150%. This is the main cause for or main pathophysiology for oral submucous fibrosis. Other causes are consumption of pan, gutkha, tobacco, lime, capsicum, having poor oral hygiene, and malnutrition. All these are found to be causative substances for oral submucosal fibrosis. Now coming to the etiology. So what is causing the submucosal fibrosis? As I told you before, the ericolin causes increase in the production of fibroblasts and collagen production by 150%. Apart from that, there is failure of collagen remodeling, altered epithelial and mesenchymal interactions, collagen bands, and decreased collagenase levels. Now coming to the clinical features. Erythema present with or without vesiculation, decreased mouth opening and tongue mobility. This decreased mouth opening is known as trismus. Decreased or difficulty in mouth opening is known as trismus. Pallor of the oral mucosa. This is due to increased fibrosis and hyalinization. Collagen bands or scar bands. They are found either they are arranged in vertical fashion or longitudinal fashion. And gradual thickening of the epithelial surface. Now coming to the clinical staging of oral submucous fibrosis given by Pinball. In stage 1 is known as a stage of stomatitis, where it is characterized by erythematous lesions and vesiculation. So they are vesicles. In stage 2, these vesicles, they rupture and they heal by fibrosis. So again, the stage 2 is divided into early lesions and older lesions. In early lesions, there is blanching of the oral mucosa. In older lesions, there are fibrous bands which have mottled marble-like appearance. These fibrous bands, they are thick and also they impede the movement of the dynamic organs in the oral cavity. So these thickened bands, they decrease the movement or opening of the mouth, causing trismus. It causes stiff and small tongue, blanched and leathery floor of the mouth, fibrotic and depigmented gingiva, rubbery soft palate, because the entire soft palate mucosa is replaced by fibrous tissue, it impedes the movement of the soft palate, causing decreased mobility. Blanched and atrophic tonsils, shrunken bud-like uvula, and sinking of the cheeks. The point to be noted is sinking of the cheeks can also be found in malnutrition. So, a patient with sinking of the cheeks with adequate nutrition, we should rule out oral submucous fibrosis. Now coming to stage 3. This is also known as stage of sequelae. It is characterized by leukoplakia and also patient presents with speech and hearing deficits. The speech deficit is due to thickened and stiffened tongue, which impedes with the normal movement of the tongue. As we know, tongue helps in the articulation of the speech. This impedes with the speech of the patient, and also hearing deficit. So as I told you, oral submucous fibrosis can involve any part of the oral cavity and also oropharynx. Whenever the eustachian tube opening, the pharyngeal opening of the eustachian tube is involved, either it or the surrounding mucus of the pharyngeal opening is involved, it leads to abnormality in the opening and closing of eustachian tube orifice, leading to serous otitis media, causing hearing defects. Now coming to histology. So if you take a biopsy from this patient, what are the features you'll see in the histological slides? One is the juxtaposition of the atrophic epithelium, loosely arranged collagen fibers, extensive fibrosis and hyalinization, and finally lymphocytic and plasma cells infiltration. Now coming to treatment. So there are various modalities of treatment available, but there is no single treatment which is consistently effective. So the commonly applied method are intralesional, that is you'll inject this mixture directly into the lesion. So intralesional, the mixture of hydrocortisone and hyalase or hyaluronidase at multiple sites. This is repeated weekly for several weeks, and you look for if there is any improvement or not. If this fails ultimately and patient develops severe trismus or difficulty in opening the mouth, we'll go for surgery. We physically split the collagen bands using various methods. Either you can go cold steel method, that is with a surgical instruments, or commonly used now as CO2 laser. Other drugs that are employed are usually collagenase, intralesional collagenase, pentoxifilin, placental extracts, triamcinolone, it is also a steroid, fibrinolysin, vitamins, and all vitamins, multivitamins is also tried with limited results. Now coming to, so why do you want to know about this? What is the significance of knowing this? Because most of the patients, most of the people in India have some other habits related to the oral cavity, either pan, gutka, or chewing the tobacco. So the number of people suffering from this disease is more. So, and also as it has high risk of malignant transformation, we want to identify these cases beforehand itself. So that is the reason why we are dealing with this today. Additionally, these fibrous lesions, they are not reversible. See, in leukoplakia, if you remove the cause that is causing irritation of the local irritation of the mucosa, then the leukoplakia is reversed with normal mucosa. But that doesn't happen in oral submucous fibrosis. Even if you remove the cause, even then this fibrosis persists. So you want to identify this case at the early stage so that we can employ this treatment modalities so that patient can be given better results. So see in this picture, this is a picture of soft palate. You can see how the soft palate is gradually replaced with this white fibrous tissue, drastically affecting its movements. See these white patches. This oral lichen planus and candidiasis we have discussed in the last class, so I'm skipping this. So last class we have discussed about the lichen planus and candidiasis, so I'm not again going to discuss that. Now coming to syphilitic glossitis. So you know syphilis is caused by treponema, and it contains three stages: the primary, secondary, and tertiary. So the characteristic lesion of tertiary syphilis is gamma. They are large lobulated. It is characterized by large lobulated irregular shaped tongue. This is known as interstitial glossitis. Another stage known as lutic glossitis. It is characterized by diffuse atrophy and loss of dorsal tongue papillae, which makes it more susceptible to environmental condition. So this is the example for gummae, and this is the example for lutic glossitis. So now coming to treatment of the syphilitic glossitis. So the commonest antibiotic used is penicillin. If the person is allergic to penicillin, we'll opt for erythromycin or tetracycline. Now we'll discuss all these premalignant conditions. They have some amount of malignant transformation potential. So what are the causes that are leading to change of this premalignant conditions into malignancy? There are habitual conditions using the people using tobacco, betel nut, gutkas. They present with high chance of malignant potential. Other clinical conditions where there is decrease in patient immunity and also malnutrition. Female patients pose high risk for malignant transformation. With increase in age, the malignant potential also increases. And also size of the lesion. With increase in the size of the lesion, the malignant potential, malignant transformation potential also increases. And finally, period or duration of disease. With increase in duration of disease, the transformation, malignant transformation potential also increases. And also degree of dysplasia. So patient with high degree of dysplasia have high risk. And also location of the lesion. As I told you before, the lesions which are located in the floor of the mouth, ventral part of the tongue, retromolar trigone, and pillars, anterior pillar predominantly, they have high risk for malignant transformation. If the lesion is smooth, the malignant transformation is less. If the lesion surface is irregular, fissured, or nodulated, they have high transformation risk. So this table shows the following condition with decreasing order of the malignant potential. So we discussed this, the proliferative verrucous leukoplakia has highest malignant transformation. It is found that majority of the patient with PVL have converted into the squamous cell carcinomas within 8 years of the diagnosis of this PBL. The least malignant transformation or no malignant transformation is seen in thin leukoplakias. So with that, we end the class for today. In last class also, I told you if you have any doubts, I gave my mail ID, but I didn't get any single mail regarding your doubts. So if you have any doubts, you can ask me now, or you can send your doubts to my work mail. I shared the mail address with you in the last class. So I'm activating the chat. If you have any doubts, you can ask me now. If not, I'll close the class. If you want me to revise any of the points discussed in today's class, I'm happy to do that. Just message me in the chat box. If not, I'll end this class here. Okay, fine then. Then I'm closing the class for today. If you have any doubts, just mail me. I'll discuss that at the end, starting of the next class. Okay. Thank you.